You are watching Work of Art on WHIG-TV, hosted by Beth Boykin of Framers Alley. Brought to you by Joyner's Funeral Home, serving our community for four generations. Located on Raleigh Road, Wilson. Allen Winstead, Farm Bureau Insurance, Wilson. Call 230-1704. Will Ferris Attorney, Ferris & Ferris Law Firm. Located on Nash Street, Wilson. Womble Real Estate, proudly serving our community since 1958. Located at 602B Nash Street, Northeast Wilson. Call 291-1123. Framers Alley, custom framing, proud supporter of artists, Main Street, Elm City.
Hello, my name is Peggy Barnes Sharp, and I am the owner of Barnes Corner Gallery and business partner with Ona Lewis with Art Ventures in Wilson, North Carolina. So basically, what we do is we have four working studios here. It's myself, Ona Lewis, Allison Hesmer, and Dwight Mitchell. And collectively, the four of us have been together almost 25 years together. So what I have done for about 20 years now is portraits. And initially, when I wanted to do portraits, it's because I had these beautiful little children and I wanted portraits of them, but I wanted to do them myself. And I actually have painted my whole entire life and drawn. So even as a little girl, my imagination just ran crazy because I grew up on a farm and we didn't have neighbors and we played from one end of the farm in the woods to the other. And so I was always making up stories about fairies and sparkles in the trees were fairies. And I see these little white lights. Well, they're not white lights, but they're like floaters, but they're white. And I've seen them my whole life. And in my mind as a little child, they were fairies. And they do show up in my work once in a while, but I don't see them every day. Even as a child, when people would say, what are you going to be when you grow up? It was like, what do you mean? I'm already an artist. I do watercolor and I do oils. When I can't paint because my mind is too full of other things, I sometimes will do some jewelry making, some earrings, some necklaces and bracelets, things like that. I even have started making bookmarks, but I give those away. And on the bookmarks, I'll come in every day and I'll make at least one or two. And on that bookmark, I'll write what I'm feeling inside that day that has inspired me to have a good day. So as far as Wilson is concerned, I started doing portrait work. I accidentally got in a Daniel Green workshop. I had no idea who the man was, and he was like the number two pastelist in the world. I was very green. I showed up with about four sticks of pastels. So green, Daniel Green. But he taught me something that very few people, he said something to me that I've never had said to me but about two or three times in my young life, and that was that I was talented and I needed to keep going. I had an aunt that I watched her. She was very, very poor. She would paint on anything. A piece of cardboard, it didn't matter. And as a young child, I watched her. Her name was Gloria. So I was inspired by that. But I also come from a long line of people that learned to survive creatively. They farmed. They made all their clothes. They cooked. If you couldn't make it, you didn't have it, basically. So, you know, those skills are embedded in us, whether it's crocheting or knitting or sewing or making quilts, or it's the way people survived. And you did not throw anything away. You figured out a way to use it. So I guess my little bookmarks, that's what that's all about. But my passion is watercolor. So when I wanted to do portraits, I went and studied with an elderly lady over in Smithfield, and she talked me out of it. She said watercolor portraits were too difficult. So that's how I ended up in the Daniel Green workshop. And I did learn oils, and I studied with him and studied with Frank Covino for about three summers. And I have since then studied with Mary White and just a whole lot of different people that I've learned so much from. And I learned from Ona, and I learned from Dwight, and I learned from Allison. We learn from each other, which is great, having a peer group like that.
Hello, And I'm Beth Boykin. Welcome to Work of Art. Today we are honored to have artist Peggy Sharp in our studio. Welcome, Peggy. It's nice to have you.
It's great to be here.
Thank you for coming. Just a little disclaimer, I've known Peggy for a couple of years, well, more than a couple, Peggy, and I've admired your work, loved your personality and your bubbly smile when you come in the shop. Somehow it spills over into your work, so we are very happy that you could join us. We also know that you've a lot of family support. Your wife, your mother, you've had another profession besides being an artist. And I've asked you in advance if it's okay if you share just a little bit and how you came about your new gallery and how that happened, the Barnes Corner Gallery.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So I grew up in Wilson, and like you've already seen or heard, I have always drawn and painted or just creatively survived as a child on a farm. And very practically, my father would not pay for me to go to art school. He said, you will get a job if I'm going to pay for you to go to school. So I was going to be a secretary, I was going to be a nurse, I was going to be a hairdresser. You know, what were my options back in 1976 in my mind? So I thought, I'll go to nursing school. And I did. And I had a 19-year full-time career as a registered nurse. My concentration was in intensive care and cardiac care and open heart. I traveled and nursed, and it was a wonderful profession. And I don't think you do anything in life and do it well if you don't do it creatively. And so, but it gave me more than it took, honestly. And I'll never regret having gone to nursing school. And then my husband and I had three children back to back, like five and under, all at one time, it felt like. And so I had an opportunity to go part-time, and I felt like that was the time. If I was ever going to pursue my art career, that was the time to do it. And so I did go to Barton, which was Atlantic Christian at the time, with Tom Marshall, and I don't remember the other instructors at the time, but he was the one that impacted me the most. He was so encouraging. And so I stayed home with the girls, I worked part-time, I had a little space up in the attic, and then I met Ona Lewis on a soccer field. We both had a baby in our lap, and her oldest son, my middle daughter, were on the same team. And we were both sitting off to the side with our youngest child in our laps, and we struck up a conversation, and she invited me to become a part of Art Place, which was on Nash Street, downtown Wilson. Mm-hmm. And so I joined the group, very nervous about it, but they welcomed me with open arms. It's a great experience. When Art Place closed, Ona, Dwight, Mitchell, and I were still a team. We were closed for about 2 or 3 years, knowing that one day we would come back together. So we found this space on Nash Street. We became Studio One. And at that time, it was a co-op. We had about 30 different artists in there. It was a huge operation. It was a lot of work. And we were there for 10 years. And at the end of that time, we both, with elderly parents, needed a time of rest. And so we moved out to Airport Boulevard, and we became Art Ventures, which was the business that Ona and I developed together as a traveling art business, and we still have. We had started that when we were Studio One. We took small groups of 10 to 15 people. We went to France twice. We went to Italy to paint on location. We went to New England, Key West, North Carolina mountains, went to the Ghost Ranch where Georgia O'Keeffe lived and painted. So it was a wonderful experience, and we're planning a trip for the spring of 2020. So that'll be fun. But then after about 3 years, I got restless, and all this downtown turnaround in Wilson was happening, and we were, you know, I grew up in Wilson, so to have the downtown wake back up, to see it die and to have it come back was a dream, really. And there had been one location downtown that I really had always looked at and thought, man, this would make the most incredible gallery. But it wasn't available. And I thought, but if I could get that building, we could move this business back downtown. So my husband and I went downtown and we spoke with Brian Ellis, and the building was not available. He said, well, you know, if you ever change your mind, let us know. 2 months he called us and said, do you want this building? So the rest is history. That sits on the corner of Barnes Street and Tarboro. And since I was a Barnes, Peggy Barnes Sharp, it felt like home. The building also has a restaurant on the attached to it called Tiggs. And so we went in, we took down plaster, we exposed the brick, we did a minimal, but it's a beautiful, wonderful space. And so in that space, there's Ona Lewis, myself, Dwight Mitchell, and Allison Hesper. And we also have a classroom. We teach there. We have workshops there. And we create there. And we have a small gallery that on first Fridays, and we have invited artists that we have for 2 to 3 months at the time. We don't contract anyone as an exhibiting artist to be there all the time. So they're in for a couple months, they're out. And that seems to work really well. We take a smaller commission than most galleries do. But it works well. It brings in people from Raleigh and all over. I try to sponsor people from North Carolina. I think that's real important. And just expose our small community to artists that they might not get to see if they weren't there. So we are now open first Friday's evening, and that will run all the way through May of next year.
Well, and it looks like the three of you, or the four of you, Dwight, Allison, Ona, and yourself have bonded over the years, you all kind of complement each other and your work, and I've seen some beautiful shows hung that you all have done. One of the shows in particular I remember was at the Arts Council downtown years ago, and it was from your trip to France.
Yeah.
And you painted in Monet's garden.
We did.
Can you tell us a little, how exciting was that for you?
Well, it's a dream for any artist to go where Monet was and to experience the same, walk on the same dirt paths he walked on and sit in the same locations that he sat and look at the same, well, generations later, of plants and flowers that he painted. And it felt very spiritual, and it just was wonderful. And we went there with about, I think there were 15 of us on that trip, and we bonded as a group. And you can talk to any of them to this day, and it's one of the highlights of their life.
It was a beautiful, beautiful hung show. Mm-hmm. Everything complemented, mm-hmm. everybody's work complemented the other person's work. Now, you also give classes. You have art classes.
We do.
So do you do that in the gallery? I mean, do you have studio room space for that?
We have a classroom, and in the classroom, we can have up to about 20, 22 mm-hmm. people, mm-hmm. and all four of us teach on different days.
Right.
So we offer oils, watercolors, acrylic, and then some invited workshops.
Right.
We
right.
have some others come
right.
in once in a while.
I mean, are there artists that can repeat and come back to your workshops, or do that you have continuous students, or how does that work?
Pretty much. I have a group that's been with me a while, maybe
right.
7 or 8 years, and once in a while someone will filter out and I'll have someone come in their mm-hmm. place. But it is a pretty strong core group.
Right.
And it, you know, it meets a lot of needs. It's not everyone paints because they want to paint necessarily. It's a healing process, or it's just they've turned a point in their life where they need another creative
right.
element. But it meets a lot of different needs for a lot of different people.
Yeah. Because it is therapy.
Absolutely.
I mean, it's therapy.
Which is something I really was interested in, art therapy, mm-hmm. when I went to nursing school. But at the time, there were only a couple of schools in the whole nation that offered it. Mm-hmm. And it was a very hard program to get into, very, very expensive. So it was, the expense of it was off the table mm-hmm. for me.
So your training has kind of meshed over now. Do you,
you know,
feel that way?
Yeah, I've actually fulfilled both those needs in my life, I think.
Right.
You know.
Well, I know it's a wonderful opportunity to get in your class, and you know, we would like to for you to share some of your students' work at some time, and maybe one day you can bring that back and let us look at there what you've taught.
Oh, well. So I think that would be good.
I'd love to.
Anyway, we would like to talk about your portraits and things a little further, and I think after the break we're going to have a couple of portraits to be shown.
Okay.
So at this time, we will break.
GTV, hosted by Beth Boykin of Framers Alley. Brought to you by Joyner's Funeral Home, serving our community for four generations. Located on Raleigh Road, Wilson. Allen Winstead, Farm Bureau Insurance, Wilson. Call 230-1704. Will Ferris Attorney, Ferris and Ferris Law Firm. Located on Nash Street, Wilson. Womble Real Estate, proudly serving our community since 1958. Located at 602B Nash Street, Northeast Wilson. Call 291-1123. Framers Alley, custom framing, proud supporter of artists, Main Street, Elm City.
Welcome back. Peggy, we're with Peggy Sharp, and she is our featured artist tonight. And Peggy, just tell us, that we ended talking about your classes, but you also take workshops. So is there a reason artists do workshops? Because I thought you knew everything there was to know about art.
Oh, dear God. No. You know, in fact, I was in J.J. Jiang, which I know I mispronounced that, in his class. It's not really class. It's a portrait, drawing, painting, self-directed, but among that group of very talented people last week. And J.J. was showing me, actually it was Monday, a book, and he asked me if I knew this artist, and I thought, oh my God. I said, but J.J., you're just as good. He said, no, I want to be like that. And I said, I want to be like you. So you get here, and then there's always there. You never stop learning. You never, whatever you're doing or trying to do, someone out there is doing it better.
Doing it better. And that's what you're striving. So you're always learning, always growing.
You never get there.
And I know we talked about the inspiration, where your work comes from, but you do commission pieces.
I do.
And you do things for yourself.
I do.
When somebody has approached you about a commission piece, do you kind of guide them along as to what their expectation might be opposed to what you're able to produce for them? Or,
I used to let them pretty much dictate to me, especially in a portrait, what they want. And within reason, you know, you do try, it's a commission,
right.
So you do try to meet that expectation. But I'm a little further along on the journey. So I'm at a point now that if I can't incorporate the creative process in the portrait, I don't want to do it. So, which has actually worked out a lot better because I'm allowed to, you know, not necessarily paint just your pure little sitting to the side, smiling child or perfect hair. I'm allowed to use some creativity
exactly.
in it.
Exactly.
You know, so.
And it is your interpretation.
Yes.
So there, now I've noticed there's a lot of motion in some of your work, and it looks like you're, you know, it's alive.
Yeah.
So, but is there a preference? Commission work versus something that comes from within, or do you just, you mentioned you do the within as a more of a spiritual.
You know, I was driven to learn to do portraits because I wanted portraits of my children and I wanted to do them. I also knew or felt at the time that because of the way I grew up, I needed income. I needed to be producing income. And so the desire to learn them and to get better at them, they were very income producing. there is a body of work that comes straight from my soul. You know, I don't ask anybody's opinion about it. I love them. I would like for you to like them.
Right.
But you don't have to like them.
Right. Well, speaking of pictures, okay, we can ask Lee to maybe bring up the first picture, and we'll kind of see what we have here. You want to tell us a little bit about that, Peggy?
Well, that's the main walkthrough of the gallery. To the right is their movable walls, so all the walls are movable, and then running down the left side are our individual workspaces. And in the back of the space, it's about 2,400 square feet, in the back of the space is the classroom and a little kitchen and utility area.
Right, right. But well, that's a very open, very airy,
it
just gives you a warm sense when you walk in.
Yeah.
And maybe the next one, we'll see okay, tell us about this beautiful girl.
So this is Carly. This is the watercolor portrait that I did. It was in a show. It actually won an award. And you see my white spots. So they sort of give you a little bit of a from earth to heaven feel. It kind of makes you, it almost makes you think, what is she thinking?
I know. And that's watercolor.
That's watercolor.
It's beautiful. Absolutely.
Thank you.
Oh, goodness. Yes. Tell us about this.
This is called Little Dipper. There was a group of children that used to come to our house to swim in the summer, and they were being fostered, and this little guy was one of them. Just sweet as could be. And there's another white spot. Sometimes I interpret those in my mind as prayers. So when I'm actually painting, depending on the person, they're prayers that I pray over the individual. And that, for this little guy, that's what that was.
Oh, well, that's special. And that again is watercolor.
That's watercolor.
That's watercolor. That's beautiful.
Thank you.
Well, we all know this gentleman.
Yes.
If anybody's been to Wilson, they should know
Mr. Gliarmas.
Gliarmas, yes. Lee Gliarmas, yes.
So this was a portrait that I asked to do. So I had the freedom to do it just like I wanted to. And he has passed. His spirit hasn't, but he has. And his family's wonderful. But this Dick's Hot Dog Stand.
And it's in there.
Yeah, and everybody in Barton College, is a great Barton College Bulldog fan, and I went in, I took pictures of him, and I just couldn't settle on anything, and then I got ready to leave, and I said, would you mind just standing outside, because that's when I ride by, and he didn't know me at all, he didn't know me growing up, that's what I think about. It didn't matter who you were, he would throw that hand up. He was out there sweeping, he'd throw that hand up, and that's the painting that I felt like I wanted to paint.
Right.
And I actually think this is one of my most successful ones. It's not only a portrait, it's about the man. It's more about who he was than exactly what he looked
and
like.
And that's what you try to convey when somebody asks you to do a portrait.
That's what I'd like to convey.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. And this sweet little
fella.
Tell us about this.
So this was an actual commissioned portrait of a grandchild. Mm-hmm. And this was done for a friend and her husband. Mm-hmm. And she does give me some licensure to do pretty much what I would like with some direction, but she has a whole slew of little grandsons, and at the tail end of that she now has a granddaughter. And so she's trying to get all of them done at age 4, and this was the first one that I did for her. And it's watercolor also.
That's sweet. Okay, there's your nature, Peggy.
There's my nature. I grew up, like I said, on a farm, and one of my favorite things to do was to lay underneath the plants, sort of climb up in a tree and look up through the different limbs and the flowers and see the sunlight. There's my fairy lights. You can see those. These actually, I do love to paint florals, but I love to paint them real up close and large. This is a very large painting because you get to see all the little teeny spaces that the bugs live in and all the little creatures. So, and these are very, very relaxing.
And that's beautiful.
Yeah,
that's another one. Yeah,
yeah, that's Get Your Pink On.
Get Your Pink
On. It's huge. That's 30 by 40. This was in a show, and it won an award also.
How about that? It's beautiful.
But it's so relaxing because you're in your mind. You're going all in between these little spaces.
It's
so
beautiful.
Thank
you. I know.
That's azalea. So this is a Japanese orchid. Unusual. It grows in a tree, and it actually was taken in, the picture was taken in Florida, so that's not native to this area, but I just love
It's beautiful.
All the twists and turns. It's kind of like life, full of color, but full of twists and turns.
I know. So was that some, now that's beautiful too. Now do you want to tell us what the name of that is?
I wasn't, but I will. So this is a really large watercolor also, and the name of this one is Talk to Me, Sweet Lips.
Okay.
So there's a story behind that little saying, but this this is going to be in the upcoming Watercolor of North Carolina show that's going to be in Rocky Mount in October.
Oh, great, great. So, well, that is super. Okay. And now we've got
Made in the Shade. There you are again, back to your my country
farm roots. Great.
Find beauty in anything.
Yeah, that's beautiful.
Thank you.
And then next, then we want it. Yeah, this is beautiful.
That's Jenna's Pond. That's an oil painting, actually.
That's gorgeous. Okay.
And this is Kicking Dust.
Kicking Dust. Oh, we can relate there, Peggy.
Yeah, yeah. So this is the sage fields. Northeast North Carolina.
Oh, goodness.
The purple sage is just beautiful when it's blooming.
Oh, beautiful, beautiful.
Old farmhouse.
Okay. Alrighty. Now these I love.
These are abstracted landscapes, and for me these are more reflective and a little emotional for me. This particular one is Sunshine After the Rain. So yeah, I'm being very reflective in these. So.
Okay, alrighty.
And they're my favorites actually. So
okay.
I'm doing this just like I want to. This one is it's about earth and the earth and sky and it meeting, and this was not Sunshine After Rain, this was Quiet Thunder.
Then I think we've got one more to show. Mm-hmm. I believe there it is.
That's okay. There were three of those in that series.
Oh, beautiful, beautiful.
Yeah. So
well, Peggy, thank you so much for sharing your pictures, because this has just been a treat to see them, and the ones behind us are beautiful, and I think this made a lovely backdrop for us. But Peggy, we really appreciate you coming, and if I get the inspiration, maybe I can join a class
one
day. You can help me a little bit. But anyway, we would love to thank our sponsors tonight for
absolutely.
Bringing in, especially WIG TV for inviting the artist in. So thank you so
much.
What
a pleasure. An honor. Thank you.
Thank you. Good night.
You are watching Work of Art on WHIG TV, hosted by Beth Boykin of Framers Alley. Brought to you by Joyner's Funeral Home, serving our community for four generations. Located on Raleigh Road, Wilson. Allen Winstead, Farm Bureau Insurance, Wilson. Call 230-1704. Will Ferris Attorney, Ferris and Ferris Law Firm. Located on Nash Street, Wilson. Womble Real Estate, proudly serving our community since 1958. Located at 602B Nash Street, Northeast Wilson. Call 291-1123. Framers Alley, custom framing, proud supporter of artists, Main Street, Elm City.